So in the last class, we have discussed about the properties of a mass filter receiver in connection to a PCM system. Now to start with today's discussion, let me very briefly summarize what we have discussed in the last class. We have designed a mass filter receiver with an objective to maximize the peak pulse signal to noise ratio. So that mass filter receiver was identified by means of an LTI filter whose impulse response is given by h of t, and the input to the filter was nothing but xt, and the corresponding out is y of t. So it has been established that this mass filter receiver is having an impulse response h of t, which is equal to k times x of capital T minus small t. That means given the pulse waveform xt, we can readily find out the expression for the impulse response h of t just by applying the folding and the time shifting operation. So from xt to x of minus t, that operation is being done, xt to x of minus t, that operation is being done by folding. So this operation is folding or time reversal. And from x of minus t to x of capital T minus small t, this operation can be performed by time shifting. So these are the two essential operations to obtain x of t minus small t. So we are just neglecting this capital K terms. This is nothing but a scalar quantity, and it will not affect the wave shape of the impulse response. So we have also discussed in the last class that if x of t looks something like that, a pulse waveform for sending symbol 1, if it looks something like that, let TB be the bit duration and the amplitude here is plus A, then H of T looks exactly the same, just like X of T. Because if you fold the signal, and once again, if you provide a time shift of capital T, or TB in this particular case, then you'll be getting the same waveform h of t. The only difference will take place in the form of the amplitude. It will be magnified by k, so k into a. So if I want to write down the expression for y of t, which is nothing but the output of the mass filter receiver. So since this mass filter receiver is regarded as an LTI filter, so this output y of t can be represented by the simple convolution operation between the x of t and h of t. So mathematically, this can be written like x of tau into h of t minus tau d tau. Or equivalently, minus to plus infinity, h of tau, x of t minus tau d tau. So if these two signals, this is xt and this is h of t, if these two signals are convolved together, if the operation between them is the convolution operation, then we will see that if the operation is the convolution operation over here between these two signals, then we will see that the resultant wave shape will look something like that. If one can evaluate this expression for x of t to be in this particular form, then this y of t, the output of the mass filter receiver, looks something like that. It's nothing but a triangular wave shape with peak value at capital T. So peak value is at capital T or TB, And this value is given by this peak is K A square into T. Now we know that the output of the mass filter is once again sampled by means of a sampler, and this sampled output is compared with respect to a threshold value in a decision device, and accordingly, depending upon the result of the comparison, a decision is made in favor of either symbol 1 or symbol 0. So the corresponding sample value is computed at t is equal to tb, and it is once again compared with the threshold. So we are very much interested in observing the output signal yt within the range 0 to tb, because beyond tb, the nature of the output signal is not at all important to us. Now, if we just look at the wave shape of y of t between 0 to tb, so it looks something like that. It's a triangular shape. The signal is sampled at t is equal to tb, and it is triangular. So this is y of t. So up to tb, the corresponding output value increases linearly because of the convolution operation. Now, this operation can be easily computed if the mass filter is being replaced by means of an integrator. Because we know if the input to the integrator is a rectangular pulse like this, then the output of the integrator will be a triangular waveform. So, if the integrator output looks something like that, after integration, if the value is once again come back to zero, if the waveform is something like that, then this mass filtering operation h of t, this mass filter can be substituted by means of an integrator. So integrator or low pass filtering. So that could have been substituted by the integrator operation, and after the integration, there will be a damping circuit which will make the initial condition of the integrator back to zero after the sampling operation is performed at t is equal to tb. So eventually, the output yt can be written like y of t can be written like the integration over x of t dt, and this integration is carried out between 0 to tb. So therefore, if I would like to find out the value of yt at t is equal to tb, so then yt at t is equal to tb is given by integration 0 to tb x of t dt. Now to find out the average value, what we can do is we can divide this entire expression by the duration of the pulse, that is tb. So the average value is represented by 1 upon tb integration 0 to tb x of t dt. So this could have been represented by y of tb. So now, if I just consider the pulse waveform once again, and if I apply this pulse waveform to the input of an integrator, so pulse waveform is having an amplitude of A, duration is 0 to tb. Now, this has been provided at the input of an integrator instead of a mass filter, because the output of the mass filter and the integrator being the same within the interval 0 to tb, then what we will get, we will be getting the integrator will compute the area under the curve, and it will be something like that, integrator and damped circuit. So t is equal to tb. It will be integrated accordingly. And this value will be equal to a times tb, this peak. So if I just calculate y t at tb, this is nothing but a times tb. So this waveform shows the variation of y t with respect to t. So this is nothing but a straight line. So y t increases linearly with t. And the value of y t at t is equal to tb is given by a times tb. So if the value is divided by tb, then the corresponding value will become a only. Now this integrator is playing an important role in finding out the sample value which has been transmitted from the transmitter side. Now in the last class we have discussed about the parameter bit error rate, which is nothing but a ratio of two different quantity, bit error rate or BER in short. So this is nothing but the ratio of two bits. So in the numerator you have number of bits in error, and in the denominator you should have the total number of bits transmitted, total number of bits, with an objective to reduce the BER value as much as possible. Now this integrator is playing an important role in calculating the BER. So once again, if I just look at the receiver circuit, so we know that the PCM output over here, this is the PCM output. So this PCM output is corrupted by means of some noise, where the noise can be modeled as an AWGN kind of noise or additive white Gaussian noise. And because of this AWGN kind of noise, there is a chance that the BER value might be greater than zero. Otherwise, if there is no such source of noise, under ideal condition, we can expect that the corresponding BER value is equal to zero. But because of the presence of this noise, there is a possibility that during the transmission of the symbol one, it might be interpreted as zero being transmitted, or vice versa. So let this will be the PCM output. Let this be represented by some S of t. And suppose this is the AWGN noise. Let this be represented by some W of t. And their summation is the input to the match filter. So here we are representing the match filter by means of an integrator circuit. So we have an integrator over here instead of mass filter. And we understand that the behavior of the integrator and that of mass filter between 0 to TB being the same. Suppose this signal is X of T. Then the integrator output will be computed and it is sampled at every T is equal to N TB. So a sampler circuit is there. It will sample after every t is equal to ntb. And accordingly, over here, we'll be getting y of tb. And then this value is being fed to a decision device. This is being fed to a decision device. For which predefined threshold lambda is already given. And then there could have been two different decision. Either the decision device will make a decision in favor of symbol one if y of tb is greater than lambda. And the decision device will make a decision in favor of symbol zero if y of tb is less than lambda. In case y of tb exactly equals lambda, the threshold value, then the decision device can make a random guess as to which particular bit has been transmitted, a 1 or 0. So it depends entirely upon the decision device. But in that particular case, whenever YTB is equal to lambda, even if you take any arbitrary distribution, but it will not hamper the overall bit error rate. Now, because of the presence of this AWG noise, the value of XT, as you can observe from this expression, is given by ST plus WT. In case WT was absent, then the input to the integrator will be simply ST, which is nothing but the pulse waveform like this for symbol 1, and the pulse waveform of reverse polarity for symbol 0. And under this condition, the decision device will be able to make a proper decision, and the bit error rate will always be 0. But because of the presence of this random noise, AWG kind of noise, there is a chance that occasionally there is a possibility of making a wrong decision. So before calculating the bit error rate, let us take a look how this XT is defined for symbol 1 and symbol 0. Now XT can be represented by A plus WT when symbol 1 is sent, and this is equal to minus A plus WT when symbol 0 is being sent. So depending upon the symbol being sent, the corresponding polarity of the waveform will be different, either A plus WT or minus A plus WT. And this is true within the interval 0 to TB. So this is the expression for XT, and the integrator will compute, or the low pass filter over here, it will compute the area under the curve, and accordingly YT will be obtained. So if I write down the expression for YT, at T is equal to TB, so this YTB, which is the sample value, which is nothing but YT at T is equal to TB, is nothing but the output of the integrator. So as you know, integrator performs the operation of a low pass filter or averaging operation. So this is nothing but 1 upon TB integration over 0 to TB x of T dt. So that can be represented like this: 0 to TB xt is A plus WT dt when symbol 1 has been sent. So it will become A plus 1 upon TB integration 0 to TB WT dt. So I can write that Y of TB is given by A plus 1 by TB integration 0 to TB WT dt, where WT is the sample function of AWG and random noise. So this is the case for symbol 1, and Y of TB is equal to minus A plus 1 upon TB integration 0 to TB WT dt for symbol 0. Now this Y of TB, this particular parameter, is not a deterministic one. It is having two different components. First component is A, and the second component is the integral part, this one, for symbol 1. And for symbol 0, the first component is minus A, and the second component is the integral part, this one. Now this A and minus A, these are the deterministic components. That is okay. But what about the second component? The second component, the integral component, is not at all deterministic, because WT is the sample function of an AWGN random noise, which makes the variable Y of TB as a random variable. Now, since we have modeled this WT as a sample function of an AWGN random noise, so last we have discussed about the properties of AWGN noise. First of all, it is additive. So that's why in the last slide, we have seen that XT is given by ST plus WT. That means the noise value is added with the signal value. Then it is white. That means it is having a constant power spectral density. Let the value be N0/2. So last day we have already discussed that part, that this power spectral density is constant throughout for the noise. So if this is the frequency axis and this is the power spectral density of noise, then for a white noise, this value is constant throughout and this is N0/2. So that's why it's a white noise. And why Gaussian? Because if I just observe the probability of appearance, probability of occurrence, so it will follow the Gaussian nature. Now, since this WT is of Gaussian nature, so we can say that this Y of T B, that means the sample value, which is a random variable, is also Gaussian in nature. Then for Gaussian variable, we need to identify the two different properties or two different parameters. One is the average value and second one is the variance. Then what is the average value for this one? We have mentioned that WT is a sample function of an AWGN random noise for which the mean is zero and the power spectral density is N0/2. Now, since the noise signal is having zero mean, so therefore the mean of YTB is equal to plus A for symbol one and this is equal to minus A for symbol zero. So let me mark it out. Mean of YTB, because now YTB is not a constant value, is equal to plus A for symbol one and minus A for symbol zero. Then what about the variance? To calculate the variance, we can take the help of expectation operation. So this is nothing but expectation of Y minus MY, which is nothing but the mean, Y minus MY whole square. So considering symbol one has been transmitted, this is nothing but expectation of Y minus A whole square. So this is represented by 1 upon TB square expectation of 0 to TB, WT, WU. I'm taking two different variables, T and U, to make sense that this W is a random variable, DT, DU, the standard form of expectation operation. Over here, now since the expectation operation and the integration both are linear operation, so I can change the order. So 0 to TB, TB squared over here, 0 to TB, and the expectation of WT, WU, DT, DU. Now assuming that it's a stationary process, then it gives rise to 1 upon TB square, integration 0 to TB, this will be nothing but the autocorrelation, RW, T, U, DT, DU. This is nothing but the autocorrelation of the random variable WT. Now, assuming that this WT is a sample function of a stationary random process, so in that case, RW, T, U can be represented by RW T minus U. This is the property of a stationary random process. So RW T comma U is equal to the time difference RW T minus U, and which gives rise to sigma y square equal to 1 upon tb square integration 0 to tb at w t minus u dt du. Now for the noise signal wt, since its power spectral density is constant with a value called n naught by 2, this is the power spectral density. So to calculate the corresponding autocorrelation function, we need to find out the inverse of that, because the power spectral density and autocorrelation function, they will form a Fourier transform pair. So the RWT value for random noise will be given by n naught by 2 delta t. So here, if I just substitute the value, so power spectral density is constant, so that's why the autocorrelation function is a delta function over here. So 0 to tb, so n naught by 2 delta t minus u dt du. Now I can take the help of a shifting property of delta function, and the area under the curve is unity. So considering this one, I can get rid of the first integration. So I have n naught by 2 dt only, and ultimately this will result in n naught by 2 tb. So this is the variance of the random variable y. So I'm assuming that, if I just go back to the previous slide, I'm assuming that this y of tb, as you have considered, is y of tb. I can always regard this y of tb as, say, small y. Let the value is small y. So this small y is a sample function of a random variable capital Y. This small y is a sample function of a random variable capital Y, and this random variable capital Y is regarded as a Gaussian random variable with mean equal to plus A for symbol 1 and minus A for symbol 0. And variance value, if you compute, even for symbol 0, we'll be getting the same variance, because in this particular expression, if I calculate Y minus My whole square, and for symbol 0, it will be like Y plus A whole square, expectation of Y plus A whole square. And you'll be getting the same expression, 1 upon tb square expectation operation 0 to tb, 0 to tb, w t w, d t u. So the variance will be same, but the mean will be different. So ultimately, this particular random variable y can be represented by its corresponding probability density function. So this probability density function is written for two different conditions. One condition is for transmitting symbol 1, and the second condition is for transmitting symbol 0. So that's why they are known as conditional probability density function. So if I write down the conditional probability density function f of y with the condition that 1 is the symbol being transmitted, so this is nothing but 1 upon sigma root 2 pi. This is the standard form of any Gaussian function. I mean, Gaussian variable exponential minus y minus my whole square by 2 sigma, sigma y whole square. So better, I think it will be better if I write instead of y of 1. It will be better if I write f of y, y only. Then I can make two different condition. So this is the f of y, y only, for a Gaussian random variable. Now let us consider two different situation. The first conditional PDF is for sending 1. So when 1 has been transmitted, in that case, this sigma root 2 pi, so sigma will be nothing but root over of n naught by 2 TB. So n naught by 2 TB in the numerator. And we have root 2 pi over here. Then we have exponential minus. So my for 1, for transmitting symbol 1, this mean value of the random variable will be plus a. So I can write y minus a over here, y minus a whole square divided by 2 sigma y square. So 2 sigma y square is nothing but n naught by tb. Similarly, if I write down the expression for conditional PDF, so this is nothing but 1 by n naught by 2 TB root 2 pi over here. Now here the change will take place in the value of MY. So here MY is minus A, so it will be Y plus A whole square upon n naught by TB. So these are the two conditional PDF. Now, if I want to draw this conditional PDF, you can understand the thing much more clearly. So this is a bell-shaped nature, symmetrical, obviously. Let this is for fy y 1 so let me point out the mean value. The mean value is at plus a. This is the mean value, and the extent is from minus to plus infinity. Similarly, if I draw the conditional PDF for fy y naught, it'll be having the same shape. The only change will take place in the value of mean value. The mean will be different. This difference will be the same because we have got the same value for variance. So this is y, this is also y, and this one is fy y when symbol 0 has been transmitted. But here this mean value is positioned at minus a. Now you can understand that if I just integrate this conditional PDF, obviously total value will be 1. However, the property of the decision device says that if the value of y is less than lambda, the threshold, then the decision will be taken in favor of symbol 0. So if I want to position a lambda anywhere over here, suppose this is the value of lambda, this is lambda. So you find that the conditional PDF fy y1 is not 0 within this range. Although the value is very small, but you have some non-zero component, some non-zero contribution at this particular region. So Occasionally, when y value is less than lambda, you can easily find out what is the probability of having y less than lambda just by integrating this curve from lambda to minus infinity. So if I just integrate that part, the shaded region up to minus infinity, if I just integrate that part up to minus infinity, then you can find out what is the conditional probability of error. This is the graph for conditional probability distribution function. And if you integrate this one with proper limit, then you can find out what is known by the conditional probability of error. Similarly, here also, whenever you send a symbol zero, it is expected that you at the receiver end, you decide in favor of symbol zero. But occasionally, it might happen that this value is higher than lambda. Suppose this is the lambda value over here. This is lambda value. And in case the y value is higher than lambda, then the decision will be made in favor of symbol 1. So this is another source of error. So these two sources of error are represented by error of first kind and error of second kind. So whenever symbol 0 has been transmitted, but at the receiver end, it has been anticipated that symbol 1 has been transmitted, then this is known as the error of first kind, and this is known as error of the second kind. When you have transmitted symbol 1, but the receiver end, you are making a decision in favor of symbol 0. So to find out these two errors, these are known as the conditional probability of error, and that can be obtained by integrating this conditional PDF with proper limit. So conditional probability of error P01, that means 1 has been transmitted, but you are making a decision in favor of 0, which is nothing but you have to integrate this FY Y1 dy, and the limit should be from lambda to infinity. Similarly, over here, this P10, the conditional probability of error, that means you have transmitted symbol 0, but the receiver is making a decision in favor of symbol 1. So in that case, the integration has to be carried out FY Y0 dy, and the limit of integration is from minus infinity to lambda. So if the y value is within this range, minus infinity to lambda, then the decision will be made in favor of symbol 0. I think I have made a mistake over here. So here the limit will be the different. So here the limit will be from minus infinity to lambda P01 minus infinity to lambda. And the decision has been made in favor of symbol 0. And here, 0 has been transmitted, and it has been anticipated by 1 at the receiver side. So that's why here the limit will be from lambda to plus infinity. So this corresponds to this graph. So this corresponds to this graph. So this corresponds to this region. This region, and this corresponds to this region. This region. Any value of y greater than lambda, if you integrate this one, then the area under this graph will give you the conditional probability of error P01. Then how to find out the total probability of error? So total probability of error PE is nothing but you need to find out what are the prior probabilities of sending one, and this has to be multiplied with P01 plus P0 into P10. So PE is the total probability of error. P1 is the prior probability of sending the symbol 1. And P0 is prior probability of sending the symbol 0. And P01 is nothing but the conditional probability, which has been obtained by integrating the conditional probability density function. Conditional probability of error when symbol 1 is transmitted. So 1 is transmitted and you have made an error, that means 0 has been received, and this P10 is the conditional probability of error when symbol 0 has been transmitted. So accordingly, the total probability error is given by P1 P01 plus P0 P10. So once again, if I just first calculate this P01 and P10, we will be able to find out the expression for PE. Now over here, what I can do is I can once again write down the same expression. First, let's start with FYY1. We have already got this expression in some previous slide. So it can be simplified like see, root 2 can be cancelled out. Then we have root pi n naught by TB and this one. So this is given by 1 by root pi n naught by TB. And then we have exponential minus y minus a whole square by n naught by TB. Similarly, this FYY0, that means the conditional PDF when symbol 0 has been sent, is given by exponential minus y plus a whole square by n naught by TB. So in order to find out the conditional probability of error, as I've already mentioned, I need to integrate these two expressions, and the limit has also been mentioned. So to start with, I can consider P01. So this P01 can be represented by integration over minus infinity to lambda fy y1 dy. That is equal to integration over minus infinity to lambda 1 by root pi n naught by tb into exponential minus y minus a whole square upon n naught by tb dy. Now, this particular form of integration is very much well known in communication theory, and this has resemblance with an important function which is known as the complementary error function. So very briefly, let me tell you the pattern of a complementary error function. So this complementary error function, which is popularly employed in many of the communication theory, complementary error function is popularly written like ERFC of U, is given by 2 by root pi integration U to infinity exponential minus z square dz. So this is the popular form of complementary error function. Now we are in a position to represent this P01 as a complementary error function. So to do so, let us make this substitution first. Let us assume that y minus a upon root n naught by tb is equal to z. If I assume this one, then it signifies dy is equal to root n naught by tb into dz. So P01 can be represented like this. I will make this limit letter. I will put this limit letter. First, take a look at this. Root n naught by tb, dy by root n naught by tb will give you dz. We have 1 by root pi outside. So this one is exponential. So this entire thing, y minus a whole square by n naught by tb, is nothing but z square. So this is exponential minus z square dz over here. And if I put the limit over here, the value of y, that means when y is equal to minus infinity, it is quite apparent that z is also minus infinity. And when y is equal to lambda, then it will be lambda minus a upon root n naught by tb. However, this function is not at all similar to what we have written over here, ERFC u, because here the integration is from u to infinity, and here we find the integration is from minus infinity to some constant. So it will be better if I go to the next slide. So what we have got so far is we have represented P01 as 1 by root pi integration over minus infinity, and we have lambda minus a by root n naught by tb into exponential minus z square dz. Now if I make the substitution that z is equal to minus w, then dz will be minus dw. So over here, 1 by root pi can be written outside, no problem. So here minus infinity will become, it will be better to write down the thing inside the integration sign. So it will be simply minus w square, because z square is equal to w square. So it will be minus w square. So dz dw with a minus sign outside. So here if I put the corresponding limits, so minus infinity will become plus infinity, and this will become a minus lambda by root n naught by tb. If I consume this negative sign inside by changing the limits, so then it is obtained as a minus lambda by root n naught by tb to infinity exponential minus w square dw. So now this function is just like an ERFC function. So we can put the expression over here. So p01, so 2 by root pi is not there, we have 1 by root pi. So I can take half outside, and ERFC function, complement error function, with an argument equal to a minus lambda by root n naught by tb. So this is the conditional probability of error when symbol 1 has been sent and symbol 0 has been received. Now let us move to the second one, that is p10. So to find out p10, the conditional probability of error when symbol 0 has been sent. So this is nothing but the integration of fyy0, that means symbol 0 has been sent, and the integration will be from lambda to infinity, because this is the range of values assumed by y for a decision to be taken in favor of symbol 1. So this is nothing but lambda to infinity. And if I put the value over here, 1 by root pi n naught by tb, we have exponential value, exponential minus. So here it will be y plus a whole square by n naught by tb d of y. Once again, let us make the same substitution. This to be equal to z, then dy will be root n naught by tb dz. So sorry, we have y plus a over here, it will not change this particular expression anyway. So I can put over here lambda plus a root n naught by tb, and here it is infinity. 1 by root pi will be there outside. Dy by root n naught by tb is dz. So this one is exponential minus z square dz. So this is equal to half of ERFC, because already u to infinity, that form is there. So half ERFC a plus lambda divided by root n naught by tb. Already we have got p01 is equal to half ERFC a minus lambda, if I'm not wrong. The last slide we have computed this one. a minus lambda root over of n naught by tp. So now we are in a position to calculate the total probability of error, beat error. So that expression has already been described, total probability of beat error, PE, which is equal to P1 into P01 plus P0 into P10. Now, if I substitute the expression for P01 and P10, so over here, it will be P1 by 2 into ERFC. Let me check the value for P01. It is A minus lambda. A minus lambda by root n naught by tb, and secondly we have p naught by 2 erfc a plus lambda by root n naught by tb. So looking at this particular expression for pe, we can find that apart from P1 and P0, which are the prior probabilities of sending symbol 1 and symbol 0 respectively, and N0 by 2, which is nothing but the power spectral density of the noise, and A, which is nothing but the amplitude of the pulse waveform, eventually the bit error rate PE is a strong function of the parameter lambda, because it varies with lambda. The other parameters are treated to be constant for a particular communication scheme, a particular PCM transmission scheme, but it is a function of lambda. So to minimize the probability of error PE, what we can do is we can differentiate this PE with respect to lambda and make the result equal to zero. In that case, PE will be optimized with respect to lambda. Now to do that, this differentiation operation, we have to take the help of the property of ERFC function. So ERFC has already been described by this ERFC U. So it has been already described, ERFC U, as 2 by root pi integration u to infinity exponential minus x squared dx. So if you differentiate this ERFC function, because in order to differentiate this PE with respect to lambda, you need to differentiate this ERFC function. So let us look at the property of ERFC function. So ddu of ERFC u is nothing but minus 2 by root pi exponential minus u square. So we'll be utilizing this property of ERFC function. So here, if I once again come back to our discussion, that here we have P1 by 2. So I can take it outside, P1 by 2. Then ERFC of this one, so obviously there will be this minus 2 by root pi. Then we have the exponential of minus u square. So this is nothing but exponential of a minus lambda whole square by n naught by tb. But we are differentiating here with respect to lambda. But here the parameter is not lambda. Rather, the parameter is a minus lambda by root n naught by tb. If we just compare this one, here we are differentiating with respect to ERFCU. So ddu of ERFCU. So that's why this function. But here, we are not differentiating with respect to this entire thing. Rather, we are differentiating with respect to lambda. So another term will be there, which is nothing but dd lambda of this one. So dd lambda of this one can be obtained. So this is nothing but minus 1 upon root over of n naught by tb. So this is the first term. And the second term is almost the same. So p naught by 2, we have minus 2 by root pi. Then the exponential value, a plus lambda whole square by n naught by tb. And then once again, this is multiplied with 1 upon root n naught by tb, because here we have a plus sign over here. So that's why there is no negative sign, 1 upon root n naught by tb. Anyway, this root n naught by tb will not be having any significance, because in case when this dp by d lambda is made equal to 0, then this root n naught by tb will be cancelled out. So ultimately, that can be represented like, over here I can write like p1 divided by root over of, so 2 gets cancelled, pi n naught by tb. Exponential a minus lambda whole square upon n naught by tb. And here we have a minus sign, so minus p naught by root over of pi n naught by tb into exponential a plus lambda whole square by n naught by tb. So this entire expression must be equal to 0 in order to ensure that the total probability of error is minimized. So to make it 0, let me go to the next slide. So if I want to make this expression dp by d lambda equal to 0, this implies p1 into exponential a minus lambda whole square by n naught by tb is equal to p naught. Let me check, because this root pi n naught by tb will get cancelled from both the sides. So p1 exponential a minus lambda whole square n naught by tb is equal to p naught exponential a plus lambda whole square by n naught by tb. So from that, we can have exponential a plus lambda whole square divided by n naught by tb. Divided by exponential a minus lambda whole square by n naught by tb. So this expression is equal to p1 by p0. So our objective is to find out the value of lambda. So that's why I have taken this lambda in one side and the other parameters to the other side. So exponential this divided by exponential this. So this is equivalent to exponential a plus lambda whole square upon n naught by tb into exponential minus of a minus lambda whole square by n naught by tb, that is equal to p1 by p0. So e to the power m into e to the power m, so e to the power m plus n, that is the power formula for us. So I can put the value over here. So this value, this entire thing which is there inside this exponential, this minus this. So as you find the denominator being the same, so which will simplify our job. The numerator is nothing but a plus b whole square minus a minus b whole square. So the formula is 4ab. So 4a lambda. And we have n naught by tb is equal to p1 upon p0. Therefore, exponential 4a lambda tb divided by n naught is equal to p1 by p0. So let me go to the next slide. So we have got exponential 4a lambda tb by n naught is equal to p1 by p0. So if I take the ln log e on both side, so this will give us 4a lambda tb by n naught is equal to log e base p1 by p0. So the optimum value of lambda opt, to minimize the total probability of error, is given by n naught by 4a tb multiplied with log e base p1 by p0. Then what about this p1 and p0? As we have initially identified, this p1 is nothing but the priori probability of sending a 1, and p0 is nothing but the probability of sending 0. Now, in case the prior probability of sending 1 and prior probability of sending 0 being the same, that means if p1 equal to p0 is equal to 0.5, under this condition, what you find, this lambda optimum will become 0. And which is rational one, because for symbol 1 we have a pulse like this. For symbol 1 the pulse looks something like that, the variation of xt with respect to t for symbol 1, and for symbol 0 the pulse looks something like that. This is for symbol 0 minus a. And in case these two pulses, the probability of sending these two pulses being the same, that means the prior probability of sending 1 is equal to the prior probability of sending 0. So under this condition, it will be rational to fix the optimum value of threshold midway in between the two levels. So two levels are fixed at plus A and minus A. So that's why the lambda optimal is equal to 0. Now, under this condition, I need to go back to this slide. So here we find that this is the expression for total probability of error without any constraint. That means for any value of lambda. And we have seen that in order to minimize the total probability of error, the optimum value of lambda has been obtained. And for equiprobable 0 and 1 transmission, this lambda optimal equal to 0. So under this condition, what we can write is PE from this expression. We can write down the value for PE, the optimal PE. But before writing the optimal PE, it will be better if I write down the expression for P01 and P10. This will complete the discussion. So P01 is equal to ERFC A by root N naught by TB. So this is nothing but, I think there is a half outside. So half ERFC A by root N naught by TB. And if you compute P10, we'll be getting the same value. So this is an important property. For any channel, if you find that these two conditional probabilities being the same, conditional probabilities of error being the same, then this channel is known as binary symmetric channel. Here we find that P01, that means the conditional probability of making an error when symbol 1 has been transmitted and 0 has been received, is half of ERFC A upon root N naught by TB. This is exactly the same what we obtained for P10, which is nothing but the conditional probability of sending 0 and receiving 1, conditional probability of error. So these two values are being the same. Therefore, this gives rise to a binary symmetric channel. So for a binary symmetric channel, the property says that if the channel is binary symmetric, P01, that means the conditional probability of error for transmitting 1 and receiving 0 is exactly the same of conditional probability of error when 0 has been transmitted and 1 has been received. So under this condition, for a binary symmetric channel, we are in a position to, for a binary symmetric channel, we are in a position to write down the expression for total probability of error. So this is nothing but P1 into half ERFC A by root N naught by TB plus P0 into half ERFC A by root N naught by TB. Now, since P1 and P0 being the same, so the total probability of error comes out to be half ERFC A by root N naught by TB. Now, whenever you are sending a pulse like this, whether it's symbol 1 or symbol 0, with an amplitude equal to plus A for symbol 1 and minus A for symbol 0, the bit energy, the energy content is given by A square into TB. This is the energy content, A square into TB, the bit energy. So, since EB is equal to S square into TB, the energy content within the pulse waveform, so I can write this expression PE as half of ERFC So in the numerator, I can write A root TB and the denominator root N naught. So A root TB is nothing but root TB. And in the denominator, we have root N naught. So ultimately, we have root EB by N naught. And this is an extremely important relationship in connection to a communication system, that the probability of error is a strong function of the ERFC in this particular form, half of ERFC root EB by N naught. And if I draw this function, it looks something like that. Before drawing this function, let me once again write down the expression for ERFC, the complement error function. You must appreciate that. So 2 by root pi outside u to infinity e to the power minus x squared dx. You must appreciate that as u increases, this area under this curve will diminish. That means ERFC is a kind of function which reduces with increasing the value of its argument. So here also, if this is the EB by N naught, and if this is the probability of error, you will find that it will follow a ERFC function and it will drop drastically following some exponential law. So for a very small value of EB by N naught, the probability of error is might be very large, close to 1. But as you increase the value of EB by N naught, the probability of error will drop drastically, and at a significant value of EB by N naught, if we consider EB by N naught value close to this one, where this is sufficiently large, so then you can achieve a probability of error close to 10 to the power minus 4 or 10 to the power minus 5, so which is acceptable one. So beyond this value, if you further increase EB by N naught, what happens? The corresponding value of PE will eventually drop, and you'll be having a much better system as far as the total probability of error is concerned. So the other thing which I want to mention over here is that if you just consider the expression for PE, you will see that sending symbol 1 and sending symbol 0 will not have any different implication in calculating the total probability of error, because ultimately this PE is a function of root EB by N naught. That means as far as the energy of the signal remaining the same, then it will not affect the total probability of error. Because if I transmit symbol 1 and if I transmit symbol 0, just like this, for symbol 0, for symbol 1, this is the pulse. For symbol 0, this will be the pulse. But in both of these two cases, the beat energy being the same, beat energy is given by S square into TB. So as long as the beat energy is constant, beat energy is fixed, so it will not affect the probability of error. And obviously, if the EB value is increased to some extent, you must understand that if EB is increased, the corresponding PE value will be reduced. And on the other hand, if N naught is reduced, that means the noise power spectral density, if that component is reduced, then obviously the value of PE will also be reduced. But we don't have any control over this N naught, because this is the property of the channel. So that's why we cannot reduce or we cannot increase the value of N naught. What we can do is we can control the value of EB, and to obtain an acceptable value of PE, we have to select the value of beat energy accordingly. And accordingly, we have to fix the value of A and TB, because EB is a function of both A and TB. So this discussion talks about the mathematical derivation of the beat error rate calculation for a PCM system. Now with this, I would like to conclude today's discussion.